Real talk for a second, how the fuck am I gonna review this album? Hey guys, what's up? I'm Connor, aka the Music Fanatic here, coming to you guys with another review of an album, obviously. And today I'm going to be looking at, as I said in the beginning of this video, in my opinion, one of the hardest albums ever made in history to review. And that is going to be the fourth album by the legendary rock band and Mike and what I would consider the second greatest band of all time, and probably when it comes to rock and roll, the greatest rock and roll band of all time, and that is going to be the fourth album by the band Led Zeppelin. Honestly, that's a perfect place to start for this album, and that is, notice how I didn't say the album name for this album, and that is because when you really think about it, for this album, there really isn't a name for this album. People call it Led Zeppelin 4. I've heard people call it the Four Signs album. People call it the Zoso album. People call it just Led Zeppelin. People just call it the untitled fourth album by Led Zeppelin. And there's actually kind of a weird reason, but there's not really a reason behind that, but there is a reason why this is the first album by Led Zeppelin that the infamous Four Signs appear. And if you are unaware what the four signs are for Led Zeppelin, it's this. At the very top of this right here, this is the vinyl for it. It's the four logos for the members of Led Zeppelin. And the reason why there are four logos on this album is because all the four logos actually stand for every single member of Led Zeppelin. If I'm correct, the feather is Robert Plant's logo. The Zoso, which is actually the most infamous out of all of them, is the logo for Jimmy Page. The three circles that intertwine into each other are John Bonham, and this one right here is John Paul Jones. So, in making the album, they actually didn't have a working title for the album itself. Instead, they released the album with just the front cover on it, but they added the four signs on the inside of the album, on like the sleeve for the album, in commemoration, not commemoration, but because they didn't have an actual title for the album, they put the four signs in there because they didn't have a title for it. And the only thing that people really saw, there isn't even a label for the name of the album on the side. And there's only two Led Zeppelin albums that actually have that in the history of the band, and those are this album and Houses of the Holy. The reason why everyone knows that the album Houses of the Holy by Led Zeppelin is called Houses of the Holy is because if you open the album or take out the sleeve, it says Led Zeppelin Houses of the Holy. But this album, there was nothing for that. They just had the front cover, which is pretty much a portrait of like an old man in the middle of a field with a bunch of sticks on his with a bunch of branches or sticks on his back, and he has a cane. And then you open up like this and you see like the full image, which is, you see the full image like this, and the other part of it is like buildings and stuff. I don't really know what those mean, but yeah. And also, I'm just gonna point this out right now. Whenever you buy an album, usually sometimes there's just the album itself on vinyl, but sometimes there's a thing called a gatefold, which is like you open the album and then there's a gatefold. This is my favorite gatefold ever. I don't know why, but ever since I first saw this, I thought it was one of the coolest things I've ever seen in my entire life. It's pretty much a picture of a wizard on top of a mountain overlooking a town or a city or a village on the bottom. And also, I never noticed, if you can see it, I never noticed that person down there at the very bottom of that. I've listened to this album and I've owned this album forever and I've looked at that many times, but I've never noticed the person on the very bottom of the mountain. And I think the front cover of the gatefold for this album actually probably comes from Robert Plant's mind, because it kind of looks like something maybe out of like the Lord of the Rings or a J.R.R. Tolkien novel, because in this album and many other albums that Led Zeppelin have released, like in the song Ramble On, and even the song on this album Misty Mountain Hop, and a few other songs by Led Zeppelin, they actually do reference J.R.R. Tolkien's Lord of the Rings novels, because, well, they weren't movies at the time, obviously. They referenced them all the time, and it's because Robert Plant was a huge fan of J.R.R. Tolkien, and he really loved the Lord of the Rings. So maybe that's where the gatefold for this album comes from, and it's also one of the coolest gatefolds ever. Another cool thing that I wanted to point out was the recording process for this album. because some of the tracks on this album were recorded in just a regular studio, but some of them were actually recorded in the Headley Grange Mansion, which, if you're unfamiliar, it was a place that Led Zeppelin stayed in the writing for Led Zeppelin 4, and just a place that they stayed for a while in the songwriting. And some of the recording on this album, some of the songs that were actually recorded inside of the Headley Grange Mansion. The most famous one is When the Levee Breaks, and when I get to that song, I'll explain it. But other songs, like I'm pretty sure Black Dog was recorded there, The Battle of Evermore was recorded there, Four Sticks, and I think Going to California were recorded there. But over half the album was actually recorded at the Headley Grange Mansion. Hope I said that right. Headley Grange Mansion, and it just adds, it's kind of like an extra thing to it. It doesn't feel like it's actually in a studio. It feels like it's in like an open space, and almost has like a live feel on this album. And another thing I wanted to point out is that the sleeve for the album that I think is kind of interesting, and it's also on just the studio, on the CD version of the album, is that right here you can see this, and it has the names of all the tracks right here, a regular sleeve for an album. Then you turn around, it has lyrics, but it only has the lyrics to the song Stairway to Heaven, which is the most infamous track off this album. And when I get to that song, I'll just say this right now, I think that the song Stairway to Heaven, when it comes to just songs that have been recorded, it is one of the, if not the best song ever made. Everything in that song, when I get to it, I'll talk about it more, but everything in that song I think is perfect. But yeah, also on this album right here, on the CD version of the album, they have 3 pages worth of lyrics, but all the lyrics belong to the song Stairway to Heaven. Another thing to note about this album is that it's actually not the last one, but it's one of the last records that they ever recorded with their longtime recording company, Atlantic Records. It's the second to last one. The last one they recorded with Atlantic Records was Houses of the Holy, and then they moved on to the album Physical Graffiti, which moved on to them recording with their infamous recording company, which was called Swan Song. This is the Swan Song logo. It's kind of like with the Beatles. I've kind of realized that in a way. Like, whenever people see the Apple Corps logo, they immediately think, oh, the Beatles. But other bands have recorded for Apple Corps. It's kind of like with Led Zeppelin and Swan Song. Other bands have recorded for Swan Song, but whenever you see the Swan Song logo, most people immediately think of Led Zeppelin. So it's kind of one of those things where the recording company for a band was so infamous with them that they were infamized with that recording company. Like with the Beatles and Apple Corps, and like Led Zeppelin with kind of Atlantic, but more than likely Swan Song. As I said, this is my second favorite album of all time. What album could beat that? Well, actually, my favorite album of all time is Abbey Road by the Beatles, which I'll probably review someday on this channel. So this is my second favorite album of all time, and in all honesty, I think it's probably the second best album ever made. This album is just one of those gems of a perfect album. There's 8 tracks on this album, and every single moment of this album just feels absolutely perfect, and it's almost like a magical album. Like, how was this album even made? How is an album like this that is so good, how is this even made? And the reason why I say this album is so hard to review, and why it's so hard to look over and review and look back and like say why this album is so great and everything, is because of how, just as I said, how magical this album sounds at some points. And this is an album that everyone knows. It's one of the best selling albums of all time, and it's just one of those albums where you barely even need to talk about it because everyone knows just how great it is. But I guess I'm gonna try, and in doing that, I'm going to be looking at this album track by track. So the first song on this album, one of the most infamous songs that Led Zeppelin ever made, this song is called Black Dog. For those of you wondering, the title of the song actually does not appear at any part of the song itself. It actually has nothing to do with the song. The title of the song, actually, I learned this while looking it up, going on song facts. I actually learned that the reason why the song is called Black Dog is because it's actually kind of a thing. It's a thing that happened to them when they were at the Headley Grange Mansion. A black Labrador Retriever was always roaming around whenever they were like staying there and everything, and they fed the dog all the time, and they thought, you know, we see this dog so much, we better give it a name. But they never settled on a name, so they just called it the Black Dog, and that's where the title of the song comes from. Has absolutely nothing to do with the song itself, but they just titled it that, just, you know, because of they saw the Black Dog at the Hedley Grange Mansion, and they were recording there and they were writing songs there, so throw that in there. And the lyrics behind this song, if you really think about it, it's kind of a tale about a man who sees a woman that he is completely in love with, or that he, you know, he wants the girl, he wants this woman and stuff, and he wants her a lot and everything, but he realizes in the back of his mind that this girl ain't really all that good for him. And, you know, really the way of the instrumentation is absolutely ingenious for the time in 1971. This is almost one of those instrumentations for songs that almost no one had ever heard at the time, because in the beginning line of the song, it's just kind of a guitar thing, like in the beginning, and then, you know, the hey hey mama say the way you move, I want to make you sweat, I want to make you groove, and then it kind of has that start stop thing in the song where it's really off time when you listen to the song, because in some of the song it's in regular 4/4, but then in other parts of the song it's in a 5/4, which, if you don't know what 5/4 is, the time signature, regular time signature would be like 1 2 3 4, 1 2 3 4, but this song in some parts is 1 2 3 4 5, 1 2, like that, and it goes like that. And you know, John Bonham on this song, I will call him the greatest drummer of all time until the day I die. The way he plays drums and how it just goes perfectly along with the guitar while also saying a little offbeat during the song at the same time is completely ingenious. I'm going to say that a lot while reviewing this album, but the way that the song sounds, the drums on this song are absolutely incredible. It has one of the best guitar solos by Led Zeppelin, I think, in their entire career. I mean, Jimmy Page is, like, you know what I think is kind of weird? The two guitarists in this world that I consider the greatest guitarists of all time, both their names are Jimmy. Jimi Hendrix and Jimmy Page. And Jimmy Hendrix and Jimmy Page, I mean, Jimmy Page, I don't really know if he is better than Jimi Hendrix. I think he's, like, equal level with him, but I think that, you know, Jimi Hendrix is the greatest guitar player of all time, but Jimmy Page is pretty tied with him. Even Jimmy Page said himself that Jimi Hendrix is the greatest guitarist of all time. So that tells you that. But yeah, every single thing in the song Black Dog is incredible and amazing. It's a great way to start off this album. One of my favorite songs of all time, and one of my favorite Led Zeppelin songs. So yeah. Next song on the album is called Rock and Roll. This song starts off with, this is probably one of the greatest drum intros, if not the greatest drum intros to any song I have ever heard, with, you know, John Bonham playing on just the hi-hat and just the snare, but doing like the da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, like that. Gets into the song, has one of the greatest guitar riffs of all time. And the lyrics on this song pretty much, I think, are talking about either two things. Some people say this song could be, like, talking about sex. Like, it's been a long time since I've rock and rolled. Like, it's been a long time since I've done the do or whatever. But I think this song is actually talking about, you know, in that time, the 1970s, 1971, when it came around, heavy metal was just becoming a thing. And, you know, rock music from, like, the Beatles and all that stuff, and, like, the hippie movement was coming in and all that stuff. So rock and roll music wasn't really around all that much anymore, and it was kind of just like this new genre that was coming in, like heavy metal was coming in, psychedelic rock was coming in, and all that stuff. And I think that Led Zeppelin was saying, like, hey, it's been a long time since, like, rock and roll has been around, like actual, like, rock and roll music and all that stuff has been around. So I take that as that as what the song is talking about. You know, it's been a long time since I've rock and rolled, or it's been a long time since we've rock and rolled, as the music is going and all that stuff. Another great guitar solo off this song, incredible. Listen to it. You know, and the infamous thing where it's like the whole it's been a long, lonely time, and like sometimes they stop and then the drums come in and then the song just finishes with one of the, oddly enough, it's a really short drum solo, but I think it's probably one of the best known drum solos that you could ever hear, like, by any band. Like, the only thing that I could say is, in my opinion, I think that the song off of Led Zeppelin 2, Moby Dick, is probably the greatest drum solo of all time, like, for full song-wise. you know, in the Beatles, Abbey Road, they have the end, and on Led Zeppelin 4, they have rock and roll with the ending drum solo. It's very fast, very sporadic, has a lot of triplets in there. The song just ends. Every once in a while, if you listen to the song, you'll hear piano in the background, and it just adds to the song. But I think if the drums were to sound just a little different on this song, it wouldn't add that extra kick to this song. The way that the drums sound on this song are just absolutely perfect. Everything about this song is just absolutely perfect. I guess next song in the album that I'm going to be completely just fanboying over, the next song in the album is called The Battle of Evermore. Fun fact, this song, if you actually listen to it and actually look on the album and stuff and read up about it, this song is a duet. Yes, you heard me correctly. If any of you didn't know this, I'm really surprised about that. But the song The Battle of Evermore is actually a duet song that is actually between Robert Plant and a person named Sandy Denny from a band called Fairport Convention. I think that's where she's from. And actually, if you pay attention to it, on the sleeve of the album on vinyl, if you look at the song The Battle of Evermore, it's actually that sign right there, the three pyramids. Sandy Denny was actually given her own symbol on the album, and it's the three pyramids, pretty much to thank her for being in the song. Now, the reason why she's in the song and why she does a duet with Robert Plant, this is the only song that Led Zeppelin ever made that has a guest vocalist on it. And the reason why Robert Plant felt like he needed to have a guest vocalist on this song is because he actually read up about, like, I think it was either Irish, English, or Scottish folklore. It was like a battle between light and day, or a battle between good and evil. And he read about that and he wrote a song about that. And he felt like he just needed like an extra thing to the song. So he brought in Sandy Denny from Fairport Convention to sing the song. And if you listen to the song, the way that Robert Plant's voice and the way that his singing goes versus Sandy Denny singing is that Robert Plant is mostly just the narrator of the song. He's singing about this battle that's going on between good and evil and everything, and Sandy Denny, she is actually supposed to be one of the townspeople or one of the people in one of the villages that is actually either taking part in this battle or looking at this battle like as a like an outside viewer and everything. So Robert Plant is the narrator and she's an inside looker, and it just adds an extra vibe to the song. Like, we have this narrator that's talking about the song, talking about this battle that's going on and this epic battle that's waging and everything, and then we have the other end of the spectrum, someone who is actually looking and pretty much witnessing this battle firsthand. And another thing about the song is that the way that the song sounds, originally I thought it was just an acoustic guitar and they tuned it way up, but actually a mandolin is played on this song. Now, the reason for that is because originally they were just going to have this song as acoustic guitar. But when they were at the Headley Grange Mansion, that's what it's called, Headley Grange Mansion, Jimmy Pace was just walking around and he looked down on the ground and he found a mandolin. And it turned out it was John Paul Jones, because John Paul Jones is actually a multi-instrumentalist, which pretty much means he plays more than just bass. He plays bass, synthesizer, mandolin, he can play drums if he wants to. He plays pretty much, if you think about it and you know what the instrument is, John Paul Jones pretty much plays it. But he found it, he figured out it was John Paul Jones, he figured out the chords that would work out for it, and boom, he played the song Misty Mountain Top. That's another reason why I love Jimmy Page so much, because, you know, he picked up this instrument that he's never heard of before, a mandolin, learn the chords for it, boom, recorded a song with it that quick. So that's another ingenious thing that Jimmy Page did for this song. Robert Plant's vocals and lyrics on this song are like awesome and like breathtakingly awesome. Sandy Denny just adds that extra thing to the song that makes it sound that much more epic, and above all, it's just a great song. Now the big one. Now a song that I might talk about for 10 minutes on this album. We have the oh-so-popular, one of if not the greatest song ever made, Stairway to Heaven. Oh, this song is just a monster of a song. It starts off with Jimmy Page's absolutely iconic and incredible guitar intro, which is mocked on Wayne's World, and if you play it at a guitar store, they're probably going to kick you out, but it starts with that. There's flutes inside of the song. There's like a flute solo inside of the song. Then the lyrics come in. The drums on the song are incredible. There's actually not. There's actually pretty much not bass on this song. Instead, there's like, it, like the flutes and like the what's it called? Like the orchestral type thing actually adds that. And so, you know, John Paul Jones actually said himself he felt like bass was not needed for this song, so he actually didn't play bass for this song. Thought that was kind of interesting. Now, the meaning behind this song is very, 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 very hard to figure out, because pretty much even Robert Plant said himself, depending on the day, depending on the time, and depending on the mood, the meaning behind the song Stairway to Heaven can change all the time. But the only real meaning that he has actually ever been able to give out is at the beginning of the song. It's talking about a woman, and like the first lines of the song, you know, there's a lady who's sure all that glitters is gold, and she's buying a stairway to heaven, which, genius lyric, by the way. But, you know, people have pretty much said the only real meaning that they can actually gather from the song is that the song is talking about a woman who gets everything she wants in her life, but never gives anything back, and she pretty much pays for it. It's pretty much like karma and all that stuff gets to her. It's like in the beginning of the song, you know, like, and she's buying a stairway to heaven and everything. You know, it's pretty much, as I said, it's pretty much just a song about a woman who, you know, gets everything she wants in her life, but she never gives anything back, and she pays for it and all that stuff. So also they allude to like the Pied Piper, which is a folklore about, you know, I forgot what the Pied Piper was. I think it's about like a town who all the children disobey. So no, there's a guy named the Pied Piper, and he plays a pipe and everything, and he gets all the children to leave with him, and he, I don't know if he kills them or something like that, but then someone has to go out and fight him and bring them back. So they're pretty much alluding to that as the woman, the Pied Piper and all that stuff. Like, I don't know, there's a lot of different things, but honestly, the things I will say about this song is that the drumming is amazing on this song. The vocals and the lyrics are just, I get goosebumps every single time I hear this song because of how incredibly awesome it is. It has, in my opinion, the greatest guitar solo of all time. Everything about this song is absolutely incredible and amazing. I don't even need to really talk about it. The only real thing I can say about this song, Stairway to Heaven, is that go listen to it. And also, apparently I learned this, in the last part of the song, it ends with just Robert Plant, you know, and she's buying the stairway to heaven. Like, originally, Jimmy Page actually wrote a guitar part for the last part of that song, but he heard Robert Plant's standalone vocals and heard like him just singing that part, and he thought that that had such an impact on the song, it had such an impactful end to the song, that if he were to add anything to that, the impact would be taken away. So I think that's another genius thing of like the ending of the song just ends with, you know, Robert Plant. So again, this is, in my opinion, probably it's the most popular rock song ever made, and in my opinion, it's one of the best songs, if not the best song just ever made in history. Yeah, there's not really that much to talk about left about the song. Just go listen to the song Stairway to Heaven. And yeah, that ends the first side of the album on the vinyl. The second side starts with the song Misty Mountain Hop. Now, the title of the song Misty Mountain Hop, the Misty Mountains are actually, like, they're in Wales, which is, it's not England, it's called Wales, it's a different part of the United Kingdom. And they actually allude to a J.R.R. Tolkien, you know, The Return of the King, The Lord of the Rings, because there's actually the Misty Mountains in that, in the Middle Earth setting and all that stuff. And the meaning behind the song itself, first off, the song starts off with an electric piano played by John Paul Jones. And the way that the lyrics sound in this, like the vocals on this song, on this track and everything, they kind of, like, it's a harmony between, I don't know if it's just between Robert Plant and himself and he recorded two parts and put them together, or if it's like him and Jimmy Page or him and John Paul Jones or something like that, but they kind of sound harmonized, and in the middle of it, they, like, it's just him singing. And the song itself is actually about, like, a love-in, which is broken apart by police. It was inside of, like, a hotel, and it was pretty much just a bunch of hippies came into a hotel and just stayed there and did, like, a love-in. Like, all it was just love, peace, and happiness, but then it was ended by police. So pretty much the song is just about, like, hippies and, like, flower power and, like, the hippie movement and stuff, because Led Zeppelin was actually credited as being one of the driving forces behind the hippie movement. Like, pretty much hippies listened to Led Zeppelin, is what they're saying. So yeah, another great song off the album. Now, one of the most memorable songs, not one of the best known songs off the album, but I still think every song off this album is perfect in its own way, and this song is perfect in its own way by the layered lyrics, the electric piano, of course, the guitar, the drumming, of course, and just everything about this album about this song is great. So that's the song Misty Mountain Hop. Next song in the album is called Four Sticks. Here's the thing, I have no idea what the meaning behind this song is. I don't even think it has a meaning. I guess I'm just going to talk about the instrumentation behind the album, behind the song and everything. I keep saying album, wow. Four Sticks, the title of the song actually alludes to the fact that in the song, John Bonham actually played the song with four drumsticks. He had two pairs in each hand, and if you listen close, I always thought it was because he was playing on bongos or something, but he's just playing on, like, the floor tom and, like, toms and all that stuff throughout the entire song, except for the parts where he's hitting the cymbals. And apparently it was one of the hardest songs that they ever recorded, because, like, the time signature behind the song, it's either 5/8 or 6/8. Now, I know what 6/8 is. 6/8 is like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I don't know what 5/8 is. I'm pretty sure it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that. Maybe it's like that. Correct me if I'm wrong. But yeah, apparently he only did 2 takes of the song. That's what Jimmy Page said, because physically, he could not record the song a third time because he was so frustrated after the first and second take of the, after the first take of the song, and when the second take of the song played, he was so tired out and everything from the way he was playing that he finally just could not do it anymore. And there's pretty much just one main riff that keeps repeating itself over and over again behind the song, and it's very much so the most, pretty much one of the most abstract and like, experimental sounding songs that Led Zeppelin have ever made. And probably one of the best songs, well, not one of the best songs off the album, but it's still a really fucking perfect song off this album. There is a meaning behind the song. Put it in the comments below, because I have no fucking clue what the meaning behind the song is. I just know that it's a great sounding song by Led Zeppelin. What else is new? But yeah, if you actually, as I said, if you listen closely, I always thought he was playing on bongos and stuff, but, like, the way that he's playing on it, every once in a while you can actually hear, like, the way he's playing the songs and stuff. The legend is that he played with four drumsticks, but I think that's actually true, because every once in a while you can hear, like, a noise, and I think that may be, like, the drumsticks, as he's holding two of them in each hand. They're, like, clacking together when he's playing, and honestly, that's kind of an ingenious thing, but it's an extremely frustrating song. When you really think about it, like, the way that they had to play it and stuff. So, yeah, that's the song Four Sticks. Next song in the album is called Going to California. So the title of the song, Going to California, originally the song title was going to be Guide to California, but it was actually inspired by the Joni Mitchell song called California, and originally the song started off when they were recording, it was actually just going to be a song about, like, earthquakes and stuff, but it actually escalated into being a song which was about, like, going in search for a woman and stuff. And originally it started off, Jimmy Page, Robert Plant, wrote it as a poem, but it escalated into them making it into an actual song. And the instrumentation on here is pretty much acoustic guitar and by Jimmy Page, and John Paul Jones playing the mandolin and stuff. And the way that the vocals sound on here, like, during the verses and stuff, it's kind of just regular sounding vocals by Robert Plant. But then when the bridge, is it the bridge? The bridge or the chorus comes in for the song, every once in a while there's kind of, like, in a way it sounds like an echoing track, an echoing, booming sounding vocals by Robert Plant. It's kind of a simple little song by Led Zeppelin that they made, but it's really effective and just a great sounding listening song with an upbeat sounding, with, like, not really an upbeat, but, like, a positive meaning, which is pretty much just about going to California in search for a woman and stuff. That's pretty much what the song's about. It's another fantastic song, and then we end off with one of the best Led Zeppelin songs ever made, one of my favorites, and also one of the greatest drum intro for any song ever, and one of the most copied drum tracks ever, and that is When the Levee Breaks. Now, if you listen to this song, the way they actually got that drum track, the way that they actually made the drums sound, is that it was inside of the Headley Grange mansion, And honestly, it's probably one of the coolest ways that I've ever heard, one of the most innovative and coolest ways that I've ever heard a drum track actually ever been recorded. And that is that it was inside the Headley Grange Mansion, and the drums were placed right next to the stairwell, which propelled up in the air, and they actually put the microphones three stories up above John Bonham when he played. And the way that the drums sounded, the drums kind of just echoed up into the microphones and gave it the very echoing and very epic set, like very echoing and booming sounding way that it sounds in the beginning. And they just absolutely loved the way that the drums sounded in there. Also, Robert Plant's vocals on this, every single verse is processed differently. Sometimes it's processed to sound echoey, sometimes it's processed to sound fuzzy in a way, but every other verse was processed differently. And also, the way that he plays harmonica on here, he used something called a backwards echo. A backwards echo is when you make the echo sound before the actual sound comes. And that's the way that he used it while he recorded the harmonica. The harmonica part, because when he played the harmonica, if you listen to it, you can hear the harmonica sound a little bit before it actually comes in. That's the backwards echo effect. And the guitar riff on here is also one of the most memorable guitar riffs that anyone can know. And actually, the lyrics behind this song are not originally by Robert Plant. The song is actually by a blues singer named Memphis Minnie. And the song is actually about the great Mississippi or Great Memphis Flood of 1927. And it's pretty much, there was a giant flood, and then black people at gunpoint were pretty much forced into working on a levee because there was a huge flood and the levee was about to break. The levee was about to break, so they pretty much forced them into putting sandbags by them and all that stuff, and they just worked night and day and stuff, and, you know, and also, like, in the lyrics in the song, it says, when the levee breaks, we have nowhere to go, and then it's like, well, we'll go to Chicago, and we'll go to Chicago and all that stuff. So, also, a little bit of trivia that I learned about this song is officially in the public domain, because it was recorded in the year 1927, so it's been 75 plus years since the song has been made and recorded and made a song and everything, so anyone can actually record the song and make it on their album or just record the song if they want to without having to pay royalties, so I honestly think that's pretty cool. But yeah. Also, the drum part for this song, seeming how the beginning of it is like a few measures uninterrupted, it's one of the most used songs that are that's sampled in rap songs. Dr. Dre actually sampled it in one of his songs, I think called Lyric Breakdown or something like that. I don't know. But also, most infamously, in the song Rhymin' and Stealin' by the Beastie Boys, because the beginning of that song, it's the first song off their album Licensed to Ill. Let's use that in the beginning, and they kind of just like flip that and record that. A lot of songs off of Licensed to Ill actually have like Led Zeppelin songs in the beginning of it, which is honestly pretty cool. I love that album. But yeah, When the Levee Breaks is, again, one of the best songs that Led Zeppelin ever made. Well, it's another long song. The two longest songs of this album are Stairway to Heaven, When the Levee Breaks. When the Levee Breaks is over 7 minutes long, and Stairway to Heaven is about 8 minutes and 3 seconds. Oddly enough, it's still one of the most played songs on the radio, but yeah, When the Levee Breaks, again, one of the best songs by Led Zeppelin, one of my favorite songs of all time, and this is one of my favorite albums of all time. So now that I've talked about every single track off this album, I'm going to be doing one of the hardest things I've ever done for an album review, and that is that I'm going to be naming off my top 4 favorite songs off this album. Why top 4? Well, because there's 8 tracks off this album, and half of 8 is 4, so 4 favorite songs off this album would have to be. Now don't get mad at me, but if I'm being 100% honest, it would probably be Black Dog, Rock and Roll, Stairway to Heaven, and When the Levee Breaks. But don't get mad at me for that, because it's really hard for me to say that, but in my own honesty, I don't have a favorite song off this album. Every single song off this album is absolutely perfect in its own way. Those are just the 4 songs that if I were to listen to this album and just have to listen to a Keane song off this album, it would probably be the first song I would go to. So, yeah. 4 favorite songs off this album are that, but every song off this album is absolutely perfect in its own way. Now, I guess since the song is off this album, I pretty much just have to talk about this. That one thing that happened a few years ago with Led Zeppelin, like, it was Robert Plant, Jimmy Page, and all the rest of Led Zeppelin were actually getting sued because, like, the melody behind the song, like, the opening lines behind the song, like, the opening guitar part for the song, Stairway to Heaven, and the basic vibe behind the song kind of sound like another song. The song was made in 1971. Do you really want... Why did they have to bring that up then? Like, why did they have to be like, oh, your song sounds like our song, we're gonna sue you for that? Why did they wait so long, almost like 40-something years after the album came out, to finally be like, hey, you stole our song? Like, that's just stupid to me. Ever since the first time that I heard this album, I thought this album was absolutely incredible and amazing, and it's become one of my second favorite album of all time ever since the first time I heard it. It's just behind Abbey Road by the Beatles, but I'd say it's almost tied for my favorite album of all time. This album is absolutely incredible. Of course, I'm going to give this album a 10. My rating on this album is a 10 out of 10. It's one of the most perfect albums ever made. That's pretty much all I wanted to talk about for this album. Just one of the best albums ever made. You know, some of the best band members of any band ever. Some of the best, you know, Robert Plant, in my opinion, is one of, if not the greatest frontman of all time. Jimmy Page is, like, one of my favorite guitar players and one of the best guitar players of all time. John Bonham is the greatest drummer of all time. And John Paul Jones is just an amazing multi-instrumentalist. You can't really say he's one of the best bass players or one of the best bass players or something like that, because that's not his main instrument. His main instrument is every single instrument that he plays. He just so happened to be most known for playing bass, but I'd say he probably still is one of the best bass players of all time. But yeah, I guess I'm just going to leave this video here and just end it right now and just saying that you should go listen to this album. Led Zeppelin 4 is one of the greatest albums ever made, if not the greatest album ever made, tied with Abbey Road by the Beatles for first place. And yeah, I'd say that's pretty much it. If you like this video in the comment section below. Leave me album suggestions for which albums I should review in the description. Also, I left two links to two movie reviews on my other channel called The Connor and Landon Show. We reviewed the movie The Witch and Deadpool. So go watch those. And that's pretty much it. 3, 2, 1. I'm done. Subscribe. Goodbye.